In the last video, I talked about the best weapons in each Fire Emblem game, but in the intro and conclusion, I mentioned a similar list, the strongest weapons. To some, it may seem a bit confusing to make that distinction, but the nature of these games usually being linear, the best weapons are often tied in with their availability and usefulness relative to the early and mid-game, despite what their might stat might tell you. These weapons, though, do not consider availability whatsoever and lean mainly into its raw stats and stat bonuses, given to the player upon being wielded. So today we're going to look at the series' strongest weapons and include at least one weapon from each game, as some in particular may have the highest might stat, but are still second to others due to other factors, like range, stat bonuses, and effectiveness. As a disclaimer, this is a video for fun and doesn't really consider much besides raw might and stat bonuses, with some exceptions here and there. The strongest for this video will be defined around that criteria. For example, while weapons with the Brave effect would arguably populate this video if it were meant to be much more serious in intent, those aren't showing up today. I wanted an excuse to talk about the most busted weapons in the game with the highest might, and so on. Without further ado, let's begin. Fire Emblem 1 and Fire Emblem 3 Book 1. The strongest weapon, statistically, in FE1 is the Gradivus. It has the highest might in the game at 20 and is 2 range. While a pretty late game acquisition at Chapter 20, anyone equipping this weapon will be able to hold it down greatly on enemy phase, benefiting from its range. And hey, if you need HP, the Gradivus also heals. The closest competition to the Gradivus in FE1 is the Mercurius, an 18 might sword with a built-in, kind of Paragon type ability thing that is locked to Marth. Fire Emblem 2, Soul and Gradivus. There's gonna be some contention for the strongest weapon in Gaiden, because of the three relic weapons, Soul, Luna, and Astra, Soul has 20 might, making it, in terms of raw stats, the strongest weapon in the game. The Gradivus in this game is 15 might, but still retaining that 2 range. The Luna Lance is unmissable with 10 might, and the Astra Lance has a whopping 50% crit rate. Discounting availability, since all three relic weapons sport atrociously low drop rates, making the likelihood of even coming across any of these in a playthrough incredibly low, they are all technically powerful in different ways. Pound for pound, the Soul Lance helps Lance units smash through enemies and can help low might Lance users. For Astra, because crit rate in Gaiden is determined by skill plus luck divided by 2, Lance wielding characters will enjoy a hearty boost on top of the 50% provided, like Matilda at base enjoying basically 64% crit out the gate. For Gradivus, it's the second strongest in the game at 15 might and being ranged, giving Falco Knights an incredibly strong ranged option with Slayer, as for non-Falcos just having that weapon at their disposal too. The Gradivus again in FE3 Book 2. While there are more weapons in Book 2 to pick from, Gradivus stands atop the rest, but instead of passively healing like in FE1, it now has Paragon built into it. And while yes, the Devil Axe in FE3 does tie for might, the only thing it contends with, Gradivus still has the range advantage. FE4, Naga, Yufell, and Gable. The Book of Naga, wielded by Julia in the endgame of FE4, is one of the most insane weapons in the entire series. It has a base might of 30, grants the user plus 20 skill, speed, defense, and res, and rips through Loptus' damage reduction. It also has growth bonuses for Julia in plus 20% HP, plus 40% magic and res. On paper, this weapon is completely out of this world, but it's so good because it makes sure you can actually win the game. For context, you get this weapon right before you fight Julius, like in the exact same map, one castle away from actually conquering the entire game. So this weapon is designed to wipe the dead lords if you didn't kill them already, and then go for Loptus afterwards, and it's the only weapon that can negate that damage reduction. The 80 passive stat points, which is the highest in the series, can make a literal level 1 Julia not be killed by him in one shot. Naga is just the Goto archetype in spell form. Shoutouts to the Yufell and the Gebulg as well. While not sporting the same amount of bonus stats as Naga, both of these weapons provide a passive plus 10 strength bonus, effectively turning the might of these weapons from 30 to 40. FE5, Forseti. Forseti in FE5 is statistically the strongest weapon in the game. 20 might, 30 crit, and 50 uses, but what's more, it grants a passive plus 20 skill and speed. Seta himself is also like kind of a Goto in that game as well. So basically, he and Forseti are busted. Nothing in this game really comes close. He is so fast with effectively 36 speed that he's basically dodging everything, doubling everything, and dealing really good damage. FE6. Apocalypse and Durandal. This S-rank tome, coming in at a whopping 18 might, also boosts magic by 5 points, which gives this tome, like, 23 might, and is also effective against Manaketes and Wyverns. What makes Apocalypse also squeeze out on top is its mini utility of boosting staff ranges like Physic and Warp. Not that it matters too much, but at max magic of 29, Druids will be doing the most damage than any other class with this beast of a tome. What sucks though is that Sophia and Rey are kinda bad, and Nime doesn't have much room to grow past 21 magic since she's level 18 and has a 15% magic growth. At 17 might and providing a plus 5 strength boost, you're probably going to be using this weapon much more, given that it's readily available decently early on in the game, and there are a lot more sword users with decent strength growths and base stats that you're more likely going to see that strength stat capped at some point. The Durandal slaps. There's also Faye's Dragonstone, and we'll get to that, just not in this game because Faye sucks, and there are other better Dragonstone users. FE7, Gespenst and Luna. FE7's strongest weapon is Gespenst, with an asterisk on Luna. Gespenst, I don't know if I'm pronouncing this right by the way, is the strongest spell in the game with 23 might and a respectable 80 hit. It's very, very heavy at 20, but it does its job of being the strongest weapon. Luna, though, is an asterisk. Luna has 0 might and 20 crit and ignores all resistance, meaning it basically scales with the magic stat of its user. So once Kanas hits 24 magic, or if you simply give Luna to a Thos who has 30 magic, the tome can start to become the strongest in the game, given the resistance stat of the enemy you're facing. For example, high-res units like Nurgle or other magic users, or the dragon at the end, is going to be quite resistant to magic damage, but with Luna, it completely tears in, dealing a raw 30 damage every time, which is pretty funny. It's so strong that it was heavily nerfed in FE8 so as to be basically worthless. Well, not really, but it's really way worse in that game. I guess I'll just say this now, hacked weapons do not count, like the Uber Spear or whatever. FE8, the Divine Stone and Garm. Myr's Divine Stone is the strongest weapon in this game for obvious reasons. Myr is a little baby dragon with deliberately bad bases, but incredible, incredible growths. Her HP and defense growth surpass 100%, meaning that she even has a chance of leveling up by 2 stat points in those. But you're more likely than not, besides her luck and res, to level up the rest of her stats. The Divine Stone comes in with a mighty 16 might, but what really makes it the strongest are the passive stat boosts it comes with. 12 strength, 12 skill, 15 defense, and 20 res when equipped. This is the only weapon, without exploits, that Myr has, and so she is constantly going to have these bases. At 50 uses, efficient use of the stone will last you through to the endgame, and she will level up insanely quickly. When she arrives, she deals effective damage to virtually anything since monsters overwhelm the maps that she features in, and can even tank the Demon King reliably, all because of the insane bonuses from the stone. Even though Faye's Divine Stone has the exact same stat bonuses as Myr's, Faye is really, really bad and not even geared to handle FE6's enemies besides baiting status effects, nor is her effective damage as useful as Myr's, given the enemy types. As for other more typical weapons, Garm and Gleipnir come to mind. Gleipnir sports the highest might in the game at 23 and gives a plus 5 skill bonus. Garm has 18 might and gives a plus 5 speed bonus, and is also effective against monsters. Between the two though, if you ask me, Garm is way stronger. Gleipnir is inexplicably ineffective against monsters, and that plus 5 skill is so useless it feels like a meme. Plus 5 speed from Garm will help with AS, and give that weapon's users more potential to double and deal twice the damage. FE9, Ragnell. The Ragnell, Ike's signature weapon, is the strongest in the game, and there's not much competition. At 18 might, range, and giving plus 5 passive defense, and even protects against criticals, this sword is doing a lot for him. This sword is just really, really good. Shoutouts to the Vagakati too, though. That sword has a high-ass crit rate. And I suppose, in terms of raw might, a fully forged silver axe will have 21 of it. But nobody in their right mind would pick a single range silver axe over an 18 might 2 range weapon that gives bonuses. FE10, the double bow. This S rank bow is pretty strong. 22 might, and grants strength plus 3. Honestly, it's kind of cool to see a bow be the strongest weapon in the game. Maybe it's supposed to help patch up the not-so-great performance of the archers in this game, not named Shinnon. Also, the marksman class boosts its range to 3, which is based. FE11, the Pachyderm. The Pachyderm is the strongest ballista weapon in the game, sporting 18 might to go along with its 3-10 range. Upon maximum investment into forging, the might goes up to 28, but you'll need to spend a whopping 84,000 gold to reach this might level. So, is this actually practical to do? Funny enough, yes. For those not in the know, there are 5 difficulties in Shadow Dragon, but regardless of difficulty, the strategy of warp skipping, where you skip to a gate or throne by warping units over there and seizing it to end the chapter, is a very easy thing to do in this game, regardless of difficulty. And so there's this funny challenge run called Warpless H5. A maximum might Pachyderm is one of the more reliable strategies to defeat Medeus, as the previous strategies of warping Tiki or Nagi over to him, attacking into him, dying, but then being revived with Elise's alms staff is not a strategy one can use anymore. Despite the excessive might on this weapon, some people have also used a maximum hit and might stone hoist instead of the Pachyderm for the same purpose. It's a lot cheaper and more available as well. This is a pretty niche category of difficulty. I just wanted to mention it because it's kind of funny. FE12, Hautclair and the Forged Silver Axe. The Hautclair is the strongest weapon in FE12 without merges. It's an A-rank axe that comes with Minerva. It's otherwise really, really basic, and it does have that vulnerary utility if need be. Besides that, since there's no playable ballisticians in FE12, the Forged Silver Axe takes the position of the strongest weapon that can be forged for 24 might. That's really it for FE12. Moving on, for FE13, we also have the Hautclair, and also the Dragonstone Plus. In terms of raw stats, the Hautclair once again takes the title of the strongest weapon in the game, this time sporting 21 might, 70 hit, and 5 crit. It's available in 2 ways, double duel, an online local wireless connection feature, and innate DLC Xenolog. So while you won't be seeing it through normal means, if you do happen to access it, congrats! You now have the strongest weapon in the game in terms of raw stats. The Dragonstone Plus qualifies for the same reason as the other Dragonstone weapons do. They add passive strength and magic, the important one being strength with 11. Put together, it effectively grants 23 might, which is pretty tame for a Dragonstone, but it deserves to be on this list. FE14, the Berserker Axe plus 7. The strongest weapon in Fates is a maxed forged Berserker's Axe at 28 might. While ridiculously strong, the likelihood of actually achieving this feat is basically impossible. Forging weapons is pretty weird in Fates. In order to forge, you need to match the current weapon with the same weapon at the matching forge count. So for example, to plus 1 the Berserker Axe, you need another Berserker Axe. To plus 2 the Axe, you need another plus 1 Axe. For a plus 3, you need another plus 2. It's like that weapon squared is how you get a new forge, until you reach plus 7, which means the total amount of Berserker axes you would need to plus 7 is 128. A completely ridiculous number, which is even made more impossible for the Berserker axe as it is a random event weapon. I, however, used hacks. So, good luck. Echoes. Astra and the Lady Blade. Astra. Okay, so to be super honest with Echoes, you could actually argue the kill power of the Killer Bow and Hunter's Volley makes that weapon both the best and strongest weapon in the game. But for the sake of covering other weapons in the list, I want to talk about Astra, the super rare sword in Echoes with a drop rate of like 1% or less. I don't remember, it's going to be on the screen. The raw stats are impressive in of themselves. 10 might, 2 weight, 100 hit, and one of its two major selling points, 50% critical. The other selling point? Astral Blade. It's a combat art which, when used, grants 5 hits consecutively, each strike dealing half of a normal hit. Essentially, this is Astra from FE4 in combat art form, but also gives 5 chances to nail a critical hit at base 50%, which is usually always going to be higher since crit rate is built off skill and luck divided by 2. Its combat art emulates the destructiveness of Astra, so does it do a good job? Yeah! If you've ever used Astra in not 3 houses, because let's be honest, that Astra is completely terrible, you'll know how fun this skill actually is. Although the skill Astra has its own benefits in that it procs in normal battle and you can maybe proc it a second time on a follow-up, it's still percentage based. Here, in combat art form, it's guaranteed. Sol's Solar Thrust and Luna's Lunar Flash are also impressive, but between the 3, I'd definitely pick Astral Blade to be the strongest. The Lady Sword is incredibly good when equipped by, well, a lady. Starting at 6 might, the might actually doubles to 12 when a lady has the weapon, and when fully forged, its max might on a female character soars to 20. A big selling point for its strength as a weapon is the Flamberge combat art. It gives a brave effect and deals magic damage. It's an incredibly strong combat arc that rips through so many enemies, as high res is not as common as high defense. Finally, Fire Emblem Three Houses, Emir. Emir is so stupid. It's the strongest weapon in terms of raw stats, 24 might and 20 crit with 60 hit. But you guys know why this weapon is here. It's because of Raging Storm. Granting plus 14 might, 10 hit, dragon effectiveness, and of course, the ability to act again after battle. This is Gale Force. You can act again like nothing happened, but it's more than that. You can spam Gale Force for as long as possible until you break the weapon itself. With this combat art alone, I just spammed Rhea with like 4 Raging Storms and ended Crimson Flower right there. While there are other combat arts and weapons with higher kill power and damage output for sure, like bows with Hunter's Volley, lances with Swift Strikes, and so on, there is just so much utility past the damage output here. You could Raging Storm into another Raging Storm into another Raging Storm. You can Raging Storm into a Brave Axe Plus. You can Raging Storm into a Lightning Axe. You can Raging Storm and zoom all over the map as a Wyvern Lord to clear the game really fast. There is no other weapon in the game that has speedrun and LTC applications like this one, or just game-breaking potential in general. Just, have you ever watched a speedrun of Crimson Flower? It's pretty crazy. If there's any drawbacks about it, is that unlike other hero relics, you need to use Agarthium to repair it. A metal so rare that, without DLC, you'll be lucky to get before Cornelia's map in Chapter 16. So don't break it early on. With that all wrapped up, I think the items and weapons arc for this past month or so is done for a bit. I do want to do a worst legendary weapons list, which is exactly how it sounds, just commenting on the most underwhelming rare slash legendary slash sacred weapons from each game and so on, but that's for another week. Thank you everyone for watching this week's video. I truly love what I do on this channel as it lets me explore obscure and random Fire Emblem topics of all kinds, from story to characters to weapons and items. It's always fun to figure out what I want to talk about next, so I really hope you like this one, and I'd super appreciate it if you left a like and a comment. What are some strong Fire Emblem weapons that I didn't mention? Thank you everyone who has subscribed from the last video. The channel is now less than 800 subscribers away from 90,000. Talk about a milestone. If you haven't subscribed yet, but these videos are showing up in your recommended feed and you're watching them, please do the deed. Finally, thank you to my wonderful patrons, whose names are on screen now. Without their constant support, there's no way this channel could be doing as well as it has. Have a good weekend, and I'll bother you all next week. Deuces. Thank you.